Greetings. Let us discuss about proper way to evaluate a patient with gastroesophageal reflux disease as an endoscopist. These are my acknowledgments, and please read the statement. And so before we go and learn about proper assessment of the gastroesophageal junction, let us review the anatomy of the esophagus that goes through the posterior mediastinum and enters the abdomen after going through the diaphragmatic hiatus. And there is a short intra-abdominal segment of the esophagus. And that short intra-abdominal segment of the esophagus plays a critical role along with the diaphragmatic crura surrounding the lower portion of the esophagus. And let us look at this one more time to get a better idea of the crural fibers of the diaphragm that act like an external sphincter. So we all know that the esophagus is a muscular organ consisting of both circular and longitudinal muscles. And as it reaches the lower end of the esophagus, it forms the internal sphincter or lower esophageal sphincter. And important to keep in mind the role diaphragm plays, the crural fibers and the phrenico-esophageal ligament keeps the diaphragmatic hiatus pretty intact. When it becomes loose, then the anti-reflux mechanism gets disrupted and patients can develop what we call volume reflux. They present with regurgitation of food. When there's regurgitation of food, you can pretty much think that this is disruption of the anti-reflux barrier and widening of the diaphragmatic hiatus and loosening of the phrenico-esophageal ligament. In addition to figuring out whether the patient has erosoesophagitis or not, Barrett's esophagus or not, it is important to assess the grade of the diaphragmatic hiatus using endoscopy. Thanks to the American Foregut Society members who came up with this nice, clean description, and I would like to review those findings here. So, when you do endoscopy in a patient with heartburn, you assess for the presence or absence of hiatal hernia, and you also assess the flap valve. So you look as you're going down the esophagus, you wait at the lower end of the esophagus, see if there is a diaphragmatic pinch or not with the respiration, and then whether there's an intra-abdominal component of the esophagus, because when you go through the diaphragmatic pinch, you're getting into the abdominal cavity. And once you are in the stomach, you retroflex and look at the flap valve and also look at the hiatus aperture. How is it compared to the size of the scope? So there are basically three things you would like to assess. Hiatal hernia, yes or no, and the length of the hiatal hernia. Hiatal aperture, whether it's snug or loose, and then the status of the flap valve lip. So, number one, this patient does not have any hiatal hernia because the esophagus is going through the diaphragm and entering the abdomen. There's an intra-abdominal component. And the scope, the hiatus is snug to the scope, and the flap valve is complete and full. Let us look at the endoscopy image that will give you a little bit of a better story. As you can see here, there is no hiatal hernia as we are going down into the stomach. And when we retroflexed, the hiatus aperture is snug to the scope, and the flap valve lip is complete and full. So when you find these findings, you can pretty much make an assessment about the grade of the hiatus. In this case, you can say the hiatus is intact. So let us go to another patient. What it is when it is AFS hiatus grade 2. Again, there is no hiatal hernia, but the aperture is a little bit loose and there is thinning of the flap valve lip. No hiatal hernia, loose aperture, and thinning of the flap valve lip. So when we look at the endoscopy image, you can see that. You can see a little bit of distance between the scope and the lower esophageal hiatus, and that's why it is hiatus grade 2. This happens when the hiatus has a little bit of disruption, partial disruption, probably due to loosening of the phrenico-esophageal ligament, and the crura are not as tight around the esophagus. How about hiatus grade 3? Let us look at it. As you can see here, obviously you can identify that there is a 2 centimeter, less than 2 centimeter, small hiatal hernia, and the aperture is open, and there is no flap valve. And let us look at it endoscopically. Here you can see that there is at least a wide open hiatus aperture. You can actually see the lower portion of the esophagus. And the scope is about 1 centimeter. And if you think about it, is about 2 to 3 centimeters, at least 2 centimeters gap. And that makes it grade 3. When you see a finding like this, you should be able to think about the anatomy. Here, one could suspect that there will be moderate disruption of the hiatus when the surgeon operates on this patient. And this type of patient is likely to have volume reflux. They may complain not only heartburn, but they may be saying, when I lie down, food comes up. Or regurgitation of food is a common symptom when you have AFS hiatus grade 3. Now let us look at the last stage or the most severe stage, hiatus grade 4. So here, as you can see here, there is a large hiatal hernia of more than 2 centimeters in length and a wide open aperture of at least 3 centimeters. And obviously there's no flap valve. And when we look at the endoscopy image, you can see when you retroflex, you can see that the esophagus, you can see through there from the esophagus, and the aperture, when you look at the scope, it is 1 centimeter, and about 1 centimeter, you can put in at least 2, 3 scopes there. So that is wide open. When you see this type of finding, you should pretty much tell your patient that there may be complete disruption of the hiatus. One trick that I would like to share with you is it is very difficult to examine the gastroesophageal junction on retroflexion in patients with large hiatal hernia, either grade 3 or grade 4. As you try to distend the stomach, what happens? The air tries to keep on escaping from the stomach into the esophagus and out. And how do you carefully examine this area? By distending the stomach and keeping the distension. so that you can have a good exam. There is a trick. You ask the assistant or your anesthesiologist or your nurse to apply the cricoid pressure. Pressing on the cricoid back will occlude the upper esophageal sphincter and keep the air from escaping out. And you can distend the stomach and you can have a proper assessment. So we have learned a lot. How do I simplify this? If there is a large hiatal hernia, more than 2 centimeters, it is grade 4. If it is less than 2 centimeters, it is grade 3. And if the flap valve is thinned out, but there's no hiatal hernia, and you can see a little bit of looseness of the hiatus, it is grade 2. When you don't have a hiatal hernia, and the hiatus is snug around the scope, and the valve is full, that is grade 1. Grade 1 is intact, grade 4 is complete disruption. And grade 4 patients, their main problem when they complain of acid reflux symptoms, they have a lot of volume reflux, that is, symptoms of regurgitation, etc. And these are the patients one needs to counsel them about their diet, keeping their head under the bed elevated, small meals, a lot of time between the last meal and going to bed. And if it doesn't work, they may need anti-reflux procedures. I hope this is helpful. And when you see your next patient, make sure that every patient with GERD, in addition to just saying normal, say normal esophagus, no erosive esophagitis, no Barrett's esophagus, and AFS grade, hiatus grade, whatever it is, 1, 2, 3, 4. And commenting on the esophageal damage, inflammatory damage, metaplastic change, and the anti-reflux barrier makes your report complete. And it helps you in your management of patients much better. I hope this is helpful. Thank you.